In this chapter, we'll be learning about inheritance with respect to OOP. Inheritance is a mechanism by which one class acquires the properties of another. We'll be seeing an example of this. The class that is inherited is called superclass or the parent class. The class that does the inheriting is called the subclass or the derived class. Throughout this chapter, we'll be using parent to designate superclass and derive to signify subclass. The subclass holds a relation with superclass. We'll be looking at an example to explain what is this relation. Consider we have requirement to create two classes, class person, which has name, address and getter methods, also a set address, and class employee, which has name, address, employee ID, getter methods and a set address. Here's how our person class is going to look like. Now for creating employee class, there are two approaches. Either create it from scratch, which obviously will lead to replication of the code from person. And approach two, somehow reuse all the members of person in the employee class. With approach one, here's how our employee class is going to look like. As you can see, all the fields that we have defined in person are replicated in employee. Let's see how it is going to look like with approach 2. In approach 2, we have declared employee class to extend person. What that implies is it will inherit all the members of person into employee. So there is no need to declare name and address since they are already inherited from person. The class from which one is deriving is called superclass. The derived class is called subclass. In the diagrammatic representation, the arrowhead must point to the superclass. As you can see, employee is a subclass, person is a superclass, and the arrowhead is always pointing from derived class to person class. The other change that we have done with respect to approach one is that earlier the members were private and now we have made it protected. Now this will be required only if we expect employee to have direct access to the attributes of person. Otherwise, we can always keep them private. Let's take a look at how the memory allocation for derived or subclass looks like. In the first example, we are creating an object of person. You can see that it is allocating space for name and address, and this object is created in heap, and the address of this object is stored in the variable p1, which is of type person. In the second example, we are creating an instance of employee. It is allocating space for name and address, though they were declared in the superclass. The address of this object is stored in e1, which is of type employee. The same is the case for third example. Here we are creating an employee. Here you can see it is allocating space for name and address. The point to note here is object of subclass will have space allocated for all the members of its superclass. In this demo, we have person class which has got name and address as data members. Then we have a constructor to create an instance of this class. Then we have getter methods, get name and get address. And we have change address to change the address in future. And we have toString to print this instance. We have declared one more class, employee. And here we have three data members, name, address, and employee ID. We have constructor to create an instance, and then we have getter methods. And then we have the change address similar to the one in person class. And we have toString to print the content of this class. Here we have employee demo. It has a public static main. It has got a line separator. Then we are creating an instance of employee E1. And then we are just doing printing of employee E1. And then again, we have a line separator. Then we are doing a change of address from 100 Main Street to 20 Hillside Avenue. And then we are again printing it. So if you try to run this, you can see that it is first printing employee E1, then there is a change of address. So we are just having a print statement here. And then again, it is printing the current state of employee E1. So here you can see the address is now 20 Hillside Avenue. This is approach one, where we are not using any inheritance. Code is like replicated in employee as well as person, right? Same thing, change of address, right? Here also, this is exactly the same method as we have in the person class. So in this approach, we again have person class, and it is having name and address. It is having constructor and getter methods and change of address. One difference to note here is instead of being private members, it is now protected. The reason is, in this approach, the employee is extending person. So you want all the attributes of person to be available to employee class. Hence, these are protected. In the employee class, you can see additionally, we have added employee ID, and we have a constructor which is taking three arguments, and it is calling the parent constructor with name and address being passed, and then we have two string to print the content of the class. As you would recollect, earlier our employee class had getter methods for name and address. It had change address as well, but since all these methods are available in the parent, we don't need to redeclare them again here. So they'll be reusing all the methods from person class. The employee demo, it is exactly the same as approach one. So we have a line separator, then we are creating an instance of employee E1 and printing it. Then we have the line separator again. We are doing a change of address from 100 Main Street to 20 Hillside Avenue. Then we are again printing it. So if we try to run this, it is printing exactly the same thing. We are printing E1 with 100 Main Street, and then again change of address and E1 which is containing 20 Hillside Avenue. So let's see what are the different types of inheritance that are possible. So in this diagram, we have P which denotes parent, D denotes derived. Boxes that are marked green are classes. Boxes that are marked orange are interfaces. An interface is similar to a class, just that we cannot create an instance of it. So in the first case, there is only one level of inheritance. So D is derived from P. In example 2, we have two level hierarchy. So D2 is inheriting from D1 and D1 is inheriting from P. So we can have D3 deriving from D2 and D4 deriving from D3, and it can go on. In the third example, we have D11 and D12 both deriving from same parent. So we can have multiple derived classes that are inheriting from the common parent. In the fourth example, we have multiple inheritance. So in here, we have derived class which is having more than one parent. But a key note here is both P1 and P2 cannot be classes. Only one of them can be a class. The other one has to be an interface. We'll take a look at this rule closely with a demo example. In the last example, we have hybrid inheritance. We are having D2 which is deriving from D11 and D12. And D11 and D12 are both deriving from P. Now, as we have noted, one derived class cannot inherit from multiple parent classes. They can inherit from multiple parent interfaces. So that's the reason D12 is an interface. Let's look at rules governing inheritance. The default parent. When a class is not inheriting from any parent, its parent is always object. And note that object, O capital, is a class that is provided by Java. Next rule, multiple derived. A parent class can have one or more derived classes. We'll take a look at example of this. Multiple parent classes. A derived class cannot have more than one parent class. Note that we are underlining class. A class can definitely have more than one interfaces, but not more than one parent class. Parent constructor is called from derived constructor. So when we are creating a derived class, and if we try to create a constructor of our own, we should explicitly call the parent constructor. Now, if we don't do this, Java will introduce a call to the parent's default constructor. A default constructor is a constructor without any arguments. So if your parent doesn't have default constructor, it will actually give an error. Assignment. A derived class object can be assigned to a variable of parent class. This is an interesting rule, and actually it allows polymorphism. We'll take a look at the example of this. Overriding members. Overriding data and methods. So we can override. A derived class can have same members as the parent. This is called overriding. Overridden methods can be invoked from reference to the parent class variable. Let's look at the default parent rule in inheritance. If class doesn't extend any class, its parent is object. Note that object is a class provided by Java. Here we have person class which has got name and address. Since it is not extending any class, Java by default will provide object as its parent. So this is the implicit parent. Let's take a look at a demo example. In this demo example, we have person class. It has got two data members, name and address. We have provided a constructor to create an instance. We have getter methods and setter methods. And we also have toString to print the content of the class. Now you can see that we are not extending any other class. We have a default parent demo. In there, we have public static void main. We are creating an instance of person class and storing it in P1. And we are using instance of operator to check if P1 is an instance of a particular class. So here we are checking if P1 is an instance of object. If it is the case, then we are printing so. Otherwise, we are saying it is not. Same here. So P1 is an instance of person. If that is the case, we are printing so. Otherwise, we are saying it is not an instance. Now let's try to run this. Here you can see it is printing P1 is an instance of object and P1 is an instance of person. It is saying that P1 is an instance of object. Now this is only possible if our person class is a subclass of object. It implies that object is a parent of person. A class can have more than one parent. So which means there's one parent and multiple derived classes. Here we have person class and employees deriving from it. Now consider a use case where we want a student. So since student is a person, so we can also have student deriving from person. Let's take a look at a demo example. Here we have declared person class with name and address. It has constructor, getter methods and a setter method. We have employee which is deriving from person. And it has additionally declared employee ID as a data member of employee only. And we have student class, which is also deriving from same parent. So it says extend parent. And it has got two data members, college and current grade. And you can see there is a constructor, which is taking name, address, and additionally the college and current grade. Let's take a look at the student demo. Here we have created student demo class, and it is having a public static void main. And here we are having line separator to print the line. And we are creating a student instance and then we are printing it. So now if we try to run this, you can see that it is printing the student. So this proves that one parent can have multiple derived classes. Let's look at no multiple inheritance rule. A class can only have one parent class. A class can have multiple parent interfaces. Derived class is trying to inherit from parent and another parent class. So this is definitely not allowed. Here, derived class is inheriting from parent class and another parent interface. So this is an interface. So this is perfectly fine. In this example, we have created parent class, which is empty. We have created another parent class that is also empty. We have created another parent interface that is also empty, and we have a derived class which is deriving currently from parent. Now if we try to inherit from another parent, let's see what happens. So if I just say comma another parent class, so you can see it is still, you know, giving compilation error, so it is not clearly allowing this. Let's try to say that we want to inherit from another interface, say implement another interfaces. So now you can see that it is clearly allowing one parent to be a class and another to be an interface. So this proves that a derived class can have only one parent class, whereas it can have multiple parent interfaces. Parent constructor can be called implicitly or explicitly from the derived constructor. Explicit invocation happens when one uses super along with the arguments to invoke parent constructor. Explicit invocation must happen before any other code in the constructor. Implicit invocation happens when one doesn't specify super to invoke the parent constructor. Java invokes parent's default constructor in this case. If default parent constructor is not present, it will result in compilation error. Let's take a look at demo example. In this example, we have a parent class which has got a protected data member counter, and we have initialized it to zero. There is a default constructor. So constructor that doesn't take any argument is a default constructor. And there is one more constructor which is taking an argument, and it is initializing the counter, the data member counter, to whatever is being passed in the argument. Both the constructors have a print statement. So this one is printing just the parent, and the second one is printing parent int. So just to distinguish which one is getting called. Now we have a derived class. You can see it is extending our parent. And in the derived class, we have provided just one constructor which is taking the counter. Using the super, it is calling the parent constructor. And after that, we have a print statement. Now we have derived demo. So we are just having a public static void main and trying to create an instance of derived and trying to invoke it. Now let's try to execute this and see what the result is. You can see we are calling the derived constructor, and from there what is happening is we are explicitly invoking the parent constructor, and the parent constructor contains a print, so it is printing parent int and the derived, right? Now so this looks good. Now let's try to change. So if I comment this out, there's no compilation error, so which means we are not invoking the parent constructor at all. So in this case, Java is going to call the default constructor. Now let's try to run this and see what the result is. You can see now it is calling the default constructor of the parent, and then we are having the derived constructor print statement. What happens if I don't have a default constructor? So let's try to comment this out. So if I just comment this, you can see that this one started showing compilation error, saying that implicit super constructor of the parent is undefined. So hence, Java is trying to invoke the parent's default constructor, but it could not find one. Let's try to uncomment this. Now you can see the compilation error goes away. The other rule is the first invocation or the first statement should always be the parent constructor invocation. Let's uncomment this and move this statement after the printf. Now you can immediately see that it is flagging a compilation error. It is saying constructor call must be the first statement in the constructor. So that is a rule that we have to follow. The call to the parent constructor must happen before any other statement in the derived constructor, right? So let's fix this. If we try to run this, you can see the parent constructor getting called, and after that we have a derived constructor. Let's look at rule for assignment to parent type. A derived class object can be assigned to variable of parent type. Here we have an employee class which is inheriting from the person class. Now in this code snippet, we are creating an object of employee. So we are using new operator, and we are assigning this object to variable of type person. So this is perfectly fine. One might ask, what is the purpose of doing so? We'll cover that when we are discussing overriding methods. Let's take a look at an example. In this example, we have declared person class, which is having two data members, name and address. And we have a constructor, we have getter method, and we have a setter method as well. We have another class employee, which is extending the person class. It has got data member employee ID, and it is having constructor, which is also calling for the parent constructor. And it is also setting the employee ID that is passed through the constructor argument, and is having a toString to print the content of this class. We have employee demo. In this, we have a main method from which we are creating an instance of employee and assigning it to the type of variable employee. And we are doing a print statement. And then we are again having line separator. We are calling the change address. And there again, we are printing the content of E1. Here you can see that it is able to run fine. It is printing E1, and then again change of address. Then it is again printing the E1. Now, if I change this to type person, you can see that the code still works correctly. There are no compilation error, right? And if I run this, you can see it is exactly printing the same things. So which proves that I can create object of derived, which is the employee, and assign it to a type of parent. Let's look at polymorphic behavior for overridden methods. Overridden methods exhibit polymorphic behavior. So what do we mean by this? The invoke method depends on the object that the variable holds at runtime. Let's look at a demo example to understand this clearly. So in this example, we have a person class which has got name and address. It has a constructor to create an instance of this class. It has getter methods and it has change of address, which allows to change an address. It has a print statement, which is just printing the old and the new address. We have employee class, which is inheriting from person. We have two constants defined. One is office address and we also have maxed allowed compute. Here we have introduced two methods. One is just a mock method, which is returning the distance between the new address and office address. Right now we are just hard coding it, is returning 11. And we have a member method, which is change address. And it is checking if the distance between the new address and the office address is less than equal to max allowed commute. If that is the case, we are printing change of address is approved, and it calls the parent's class change address to do the actual change of address. If the distance between the old and the new address is greater than max allowed commute, then it is printing a message saying that change of address is not approved. This is a very simple implementation of overriding methods. We have employee demo. In the employee demo, we have a static main method. We are creating an instance of employee. We are attempting to change the address. And again, we are trying to. Now let's try to run this and see what the result looks like. So here is our employee demo. So here you can see that it is printing E1, which has got some address, and it is trying to change the address, but you can see that change of address is not approved. And you can see it is still remaining the same. And this is because here we have hard coded to be returning 11. You know, 11 is greater than 10, so hence it is not allowing. So let's now change this to 9 so that it falls within this particular limit. And we can try to rerun this. And you can see change of address is approved. So now our new address has changed to 20 Hillside Avenue. So this is called method overriding. The interesting thing to note here is, though we have redefined address here, you can see that it is still leveraging the change of address done by the superclass. So it is adding some custom logic, and if that condition is met, only then it is invoking the parent's change address. So this is the beauty of method overriding. We should be overriding when we want to kind of build additional functionality, and that additional functionality will belong to the subclass, and it will still reuse the method in the parent class. In this demo example, we are reusing the person and the employee class. Person has name and address, and it also has change address method, which allows it to change the address. And we have employee class, which is inheriting from person. It also has its own version of change address. If the distance between the new and the office address is less than or equal to maximum allowed, it is calling the parent's class change address to do the actual change of address. Otherwise, it is saying that change of address is not approved. And here we have just hard coded the distance between the old and the new to be always 9. So hence it is going to be always approved. Now in the employee demo class, we have a main method creating an instance of person. So Tom is our person who lives at 100 Chuck Lane. We are doing a change of address for Tom. And later on, we are creating an instance of employee, assigning it to OBJ1. For John also, we are changing an address. If I try to run this, so in the first case, you can see the person constructor is invoked and it is creating the person object. And in this case, it is invoking the change address that belongs to only person, right? Because our object is of type person. Later on, we are creating the employee object. So in this case, John is our employee. You can see that it is invoking the change address of employee class, right? You can see that it is printing change of address approved, which is only available in the employee class. So you can see, though we are using the same variable, which change address gets invoked depends upon what object is assigned at runtime. So this is called runtime polymorphism. This is exhibited by overridden methods. Let's look at pros and cons of inheritance. We saw that with example of employee and person. Employee class had code which was specific to employee only. All non-private methods of superclass are available to its subclass. Naturally, this leads to more modular code. Logic specific to a class is defined in that class only. This also leads to improved testability. As we saw, when method is overridden, appropriate methods get invoked. So it exhibits runtime polymorphism. In terms of disadvantages, a change in parent class might impact the child class. So we have to be very careful how subclasses are implemented. Let's look at some of the common questions that are asked with respect to inheritance. How to access parent members from a subclass? Use the super keyword. Can we call parent constructors from subclass? Yes, absolutely. Again, use a super keyword with appropriate arguments. Which class modifier can be used in superclass? So generally, if the data members are not supposed to be used or you don't want to expose it to any of the subclasses, use private. Otherwise, generally, they can be protected. When instance of subclass is created, does it allocate memory for parent class data members? Yes. The instance of subclass will contain members of parent and subclass as well. Can we assign object of subclass to variable of type parent? Yes. Example, parent P equals to new derived. Assuming derived is a subclass of parent. Can we have method with same signature in parent and subclass? Yes, we can. This is called method overriding. If we have overridden method, which method would get invoked? The method that gets invoked depends upon the object that is referenced. So in our previous example, the overridden method in derive will get invoked. If we assign P as new parent, then parent's method will get invoked. This is called runtime polymorphism.